Hello, everyone. This is Alice in Beijing. I'm so glad to meet you on this iCANX-Talks. We connect the world and the universe. And today is a very special day. Everyone knows that today we are May Day, May 1st. And named the May Day, also named an International Labor Day. So I'm so, so happy to work together with you on this International Labor Day. We are all hardworking persons. This was the third time for iCANX-Talks. Everyone knows that in the previous two sessions, we have the top scientists, but John Rogers, Tony Huang, Zhongming Wang, Xuan He from the worldwide, and they deliver very great talks, and they attract a lot of attention. And not only this, all topics was so attractive, and the scientists was working so well. We also get additional service was from our students. Our students, you know, writing the technical report, yeah, after the talk, and then deliver to everyone to can see that high-tech report for help you to understand the topics of all this high-tech. And this was all very popular too. I'm so proud of the students. They are also hardworking like us. And now everyone knows that iCANX-Talks. This became a popular talk show for high tech. We connect everyone on the world and the universe. We show all this high tech. We show all these futures techniques and science. And today, the same as before, we invited, you know, the top scientists worldwide. We invited the people, you know, who do excellent work. The first speaker here is Yury Gogotsi. He's very famous. He's from, you know, Drexel University. He got that a lot of things. And he also invented a lot of new technologies and materials. And today, his topic will be the rise of MXenes. Impact of material discovery on technology progress. Everyone knows that since 10 years ago, almost 10 years, is 9 years ago, Yury was invented this MXenes material. So it's getting to be one very, very important 2D material in many fields. So today, the inventor of this MXenes, the most popular 2D material, he will tell us his story for the impact of this material discovery. And then he will tell how to, you know, application for all these amazing materials. He is a super speaker too. Yury, are you ready? Yeah, if you're ready, yeah, please turn on your slides, share your screen. And as Yury, you know, the word is yours. Welcome, Yury.
Good morning, everyone in America. Good evening, everyone in Asia, and good day to everyone in Europe, India, or elsewhere. And I hope you will be able to see my screen momentarily. Thank you very much, Alice, for introduction. And I'm truly delighted to speak after several absolutely outstanding scientists who gave talks last week and a week before. And I'm going to cover a somewhat different topic. I will talk about new materials, discovery of materials, and their role. Those are two-dimensional materials we'll call MXenes, and what is great, there are many of them. This is not just a material, those are many materials. And actually the title of my talk was inspired by an editorial that I wrote with my former postdoc and now professor in Indiana, Baba Kanasuri, called The Rise of MXenes, which was published in ACS Nano. Today is the ACS Nano Day. And I'm warming you up for a great talk given by our editor-in-chief, Paul Weiss. And ACS Nano is really one of the top journals. And what is great, it has a great team of editors here. So something to consider when you write your next paper. But Let me go back from current material discovery to the very past. For ages, from Stone Age to Silicon Age, people have been crafting tools by carving them out of either a piece of stone, wood, bone, or later from metals, making stronger weapons, better materials, making machinery that led us to a technological revolution. And actually, even with discovery of polymers, lighter metal aluminum, Silicon Age, we all now use computers, or iPads, or you may be using smartphone to watch this technology show. We're in the Silicon Age, but what we still do, just like in a Stone Age, we carve out something out of silicon, but also we start adding stuff. And as we move into the new reality, we really need new materials. We need to learn how to make materials that will push technology further. And what you can see, the technological progress has been accelerating very quickly. And much of this is thanks to new materials here. For example, we are already moving into the Internet of Things era. We have more devices connected in the world already than the number of people living in this world. Even though not everyone of 7.7 billion people in the world has a device now. And these devices become smaller, smarter. We consider our smartphones to be great, but do we want to always carry this heavy piece of machinery? Probably not. We expect moving to the stage when we will be wearing our electronics, when we will be moving into the age of textile-based electronics, simply because everyone wears textiles. Textiles cover much of our human body. We wear them almost virtually all the time and or are surrounded by textiles even when we sleep here. And the next step may actually be skin electronics. Some of you might have heard the first talk given by John Rogers about these things. So what do we need to enter this era of new different materials? Materials which will be flexible. Materials which will change properties on demand. Materials that can be worked into textiles, fibers, thin films, materials that will be transparent or change their color, their properties, materials that will be able to transmit, receive signal, sense. We definitely need something else. We cannot carve all this out of a piece of iron or silicon or even the best, most advanced steel. We need to be able to build. We need to be able to build many different functions into material. And definitely carbon nanomaterials, and you can see here graphene, have played a huge role in this game, in our move towards the nanomaterials, artificially designed materials world here. And it started not with graphene. It started with fullerenes, carbon nanotubes. This is largely when the nanotechnology era arrived. But Professor Yan Li will be talking about nanotubes, and I'm not going to get into that domain. But what you also noticed, fullerenes were great for science. They really showed us opportunities, new opportunities in the nano world. When we learn how to design different shapes, get different properties by controlling matter at the atomistic scale, making complex shapes. But they really did not meet expectations. There are very few applications at the moment, even though the impact on science was tremendous. Carbon nanotubes already made into many industries. You will find them probably in the battery of every cell phone or computer you use. But what is important about graphene? Why discovery of graphene caused so much interest and Andrew Geim, Kostya Novoselov received Nobel Prize for it here. Not only because of interest in physical properties, but it really woke up the field of two-dimensional materials. People realize there are building blocks that you can pile up one by one, basically adding them in the way we built a wall from different bricks, bringing different properties, bringing new materials, metamaterials at the nanoscale building devices. Moreover, people started to pay attention to old materials, transition metal dichalcogenide, like molydisulfide. They were discovered even before graphene in single layer sheets, or hexagonal boron nitride, which is isostructural to graphene, or clays, oxide, hydroxide. But what is also important, new materials which were not known to exist in a two-dimensional state, which don't have necessarily like a natural precursors, unlike say molydisulfide or tungsten disulfide, metal organic frameworks, black phosphorus, silicin, germanin, 2D metals. They were discovered when people realized it's possible to build materials in a two-dimensional state. And in 2011, with my colleagues at Drexel University, we also showed that carbides and nitrides of transition metal can be made in a 2D. So why also two-dimensional material are so unique? They have a variety of electronic properties. They provide metals, semiconductors, insulators. So basically all materials, all properties we need for electronic industry. They're atomically thin, they're optically transparent, pretty much any material when it's just a couple of nanometers thin will be transparent. They're flexible. So all this flexible, wearable electronics we need cannot be built from bulk materials. Even metal foils or glass will eventually degrade when they are deformed strongly and multiple times. 2D material provides this opportunity. And also their high specific area adds to exciting electrochemical properties. Surface reversible reaction, catalysis, adsorption, many others. So basically the material science field is changing. We move from bulk materials, from phase diagrams, from equilibrium thermodynamics to non-equilibrium nanomaterials. And carbides and nitrides of transition metal, which we called MXenes, where M stands for a transition metal, this golden sphere here. X is carbon or nitrogen, but you can imagine boron as the element in this place, are materials we deal with here. So what is important about them? There are a few items seen, just like molydisulfide, for example, here, but there are many two-dimensional materials that are semiconductors, dielectrics, but there are really hardly any good metals with high electronic conductivity. Even graphene, as people better conductors than copper. In fact, it's a zero band gap semiconductor with very few free carriers, unless doped here. But MXenes have in the core electrons of transition metals like titanium or moly or tungsten. But their surface looks like a surface of transition metal oxide or hydroxide. I showed them here OH terminated, for example. So basically they combine properties of metals and oxides. You can look at them as a conductive clay or metallic graphene oxide. Moreover, as I already mentioned, they come in many different flavors. They can be structures with two transition metal layers, one layer of carbon nitrogen, or four layers of transition metal. We call them 4-3, 3-2, 2-1 structures. And Michael Nagib, PhD student who worked with Professor Michel Barzoum and myself at Drexel University, who was the first one to make the first MXene titanium 3C2, which was published in this article in Advanced Materials. During his PhD study, he discovered a dozen of those materials showing that carbides, carbon nitrides are possible, these three structures. Moreover, solid solution on M side, solid solution on N side. So basically, we have a very large family of materials now with more than 100 of stoichiometric structures predicted. And soon after, further discoveries were made. We moved from the first titanium 3C2 discovery at MXene to an entire family of materials. The community developed different etching methods. Later also, atomic sandwich structure were discovered, where one metal, for example, moly, can be on the surface, another transition metal in the middle, or two transition metal layer of titanium, for example, sandwiched by layer of moly. So we basically push atomistic or nanoscale engineering to the limit, where we can design structure like that. And scientists at Linköping University showed that it's possible to make MXenes with ordered divacancies, where one column, atomic column of atoms in missing, forming the structures. And discoveries continue. So what we have now, we have this very large and growing family of materials with carbides, nitrides, carbon nitride, simple structures. These atomic sandwiches or divacancy materials or materials we have single, double atomic columns on the surface of different transition metals. Moreover, we can have solid solution on X and M sites, which basically form an infinite number of compositions. So we not only have a new family of two-dimensional materials, we have probably the largest known family of materials. And discovery is not going to stop here. After Babak showed the atomic sandwich structures recently, just published in this year in ACS Nano Engineering issue, we showed that we can extend N from 3 to 4. We can make materials with 5 layers of transition metal and 4 layers of carbon. And I'm sure this discovery will continue. There will be many more materials added to this system. There will be borides added to this system. There will be other interesting structure developed because now we can do it. Now, it's great to have dozens or potentially hundreds of new materials, but are they good for anything? They're only useful if they can add something to current materials variety, already 200 probably materials available in the 2D space. What is interesting, all bare MXene would be metallic. However, surface terminations that I mentioned to you that play a major role, they allow to sometimes open the band gap, for example, in oxygen terminated titanium 2C or other carbides, where oxygen pulls 2 electrons extra from titanium atom on the surface. Many exciting properties, from giant Seebeck coefficient for thermoelectric materials to very high Hall mobility to Dirac fermions, so basically cons in the band structure, like in graphene, to chemically tunable superconductivity, tunable work functions, and topological insulator have been predicted in this system. Many of those properties are still to be checked experimentally. But I just want to show that even when MXenes are metallic, they're also very interesting metals because their band gap can be tuned by changing and changing reversibly surface terminations, for example, by electrochemical oxidation, or of course by strain, just like it has been predicted and demonstrated for some other materials. This is, for example, density of states, and you see high density of state is a Fermi level in titanium 2C MXene with no termination. In air, in practical synthesis condition, it doesn't happen. But if you get fluorine on the surface, you see a decrease in density of state. If oxygen surface termination is obtained, we can open the band gap. And kind of a wider band gap have been predicted for some MXenes here. But really, I will be focusing on their metallicity just because this is what has been really missing in the domain of 2D materials. But I just wanted to mention also that DFT predicts that it's possible to control properties like, for example, magnetism in the 2D materials, not only by controlling transition metal like titanium, chromium, manganese, but also changing surface termination. So in reality, for each of the MXene I'm talking about, we really talk about many, many materials because depending on what we put on the surface and remember, we chemically bonded to the surface. But even with chemical bonding of oxygen OH to the surface, we can still keep this material metallic. Unlike in graphene, when oxygen terminates the surface and graphene oxide is formed and conductivity is gone, we can go to conductivity which is roughly like a 10 times higher than in reducing graphene oxide in multi-layer film of MXenes. When we take these flakes, and this is about like a 15-20 micron single layer flake of material, those like a single crystalline, as you can see from selected array diffraction. And if you have a second one, it can be in registry with the first layer here. But many of them are metals. And this is what I'm going to talk about largely today, about the interesting properties of this metal. They're very strong metals with extremely high mechanical properties, but they're transparent. Actually, titanium C2 MXenes is more transparent than graphene. It absorbs less visible light for the same thickness here. But they also have OH termination on the surface or oxygen or some acid that makes them hydrophilic. So we can disperse them in water. We can make colloidal solution and processes just from water solution here. And they can absorb light, different wavelengths, depending on the type of materials. And they have large tunable surfaces. And there are many of them. Naturally, when we have any 2D material, we always compare it to its graphene. We're talking in this case about materials produced by wet chemical synthesis. So naturally, we can compare it to graphene oxide, reducing graphene oxide. And as I mentioned, it's hydrophilic and water soluble, like graphene oxide. It's 5 to 10 times more conducting than RGO films you find published. It's actually stiffer, just because there are a few atoms in thickness, so you get an order of 2 orders of magnitude higher bending rigidity. So you really have not flimsy flakes, you have stronger flakes that can stay straight, and higher modulus and strands, and more transparent. So basically consider that combination of graphene oxide and reducing graphene oxide properties on steroids in one material. And those are properties are tunable, and we have this variety of materials here. Does it mean that we don't need any other 2D materials? Of course not. We will be talking in many cases about heterostructures, about combining different materials, for example, like anode and cathode of a battery, or combining this in one multi-layered hybrid structure here. But now let me go back a little bit and tell you how we make these materials. It's actually currently made primarily by etching, delamination of so-known MUX phases. A colleague of mine, Professor Michel Barzum, with whom we worked on developing these materials, is a father of entire field of layered ceramics known as MUX phases, where layers of carbides or nitrides are separated by monatomic layer of A element, one of these blue ones here. So what we do, we just etch, remove away monatomic layer of A element, producing this variety of structures that I mentioned to you before. And people actually continue developing this family of ceramics, MUX phases, adding new and new composition and structure to it here. And MUX phases are not the only ones that can be used. There are other layered carbides and nitrides. For example, some like moly-2, gallium-2C with 2 layers of gallium metal that need to be etched away. Or structures having aluminum carbide layers, separating layer of transition metal carbides. What distinguishes synthesis of MXenes from, say, delamination exfoliation of graphite? There are strong metallic or covalent bonds between those A elements, typically aluminum, silicon, but as you see, other elements can also be there, and transition metals, the golden colored ones here. So we have to etch them. Typically, we use acids, but molten salt, alkaline solution can be used. I'm not going to talk about a lot about synthesis today, because otherwise I would spend an entire hour on this. What you need just to know that there are many ways to etch, there are many precursors, and depending how you etch, you will get different surface chemistries. And after that, we get particles that look very much like vermiculite clay or thermally expanded graphite, which we can disperse, delaminate, and make single layer flakes by very similar methods that you use to delaminate other 2D materials. What is also very important, you read about discovery of new materials all the time. Majority of them, great majority of them, 99% of them, will never be used. They are produced in nano quantities. For practical application, especially if we talk about chemically synthesized materials, we need large amount. And from day one, we were able to make MXenes gram quantities. But we showed now that we can make 50 gram, 100 gram batches in a reactor that is produced for our lab by Material Research Center in Ukraine. And we have exactly the same properties in larger batch compared to smaller batch. We can delaminate this material into single layer flakes that are floating now in this 1 liter bottle of solution and cover it virtually an entire football field with a monolayer of this material. And not only titanium 32, here you can see, for example, 40 gram of this atomic sandwich structure molybdenum titanium C2. Imagine what is the area that single layer flakes that are needed in many application or micron thin films can cover here. But what is also beautiful, these flakes can be dissolved very easily in water. We don't need surfactant. We don't need any additives to have a stable colloidal solution because zeta potential for most of them is well below minus 30 millivolt. So they are Lewis acids, they are negatively charged in solution. So we can work with pure water. We can print from pure water. But if you look at a droplet of solution dried on a microscope grid, you will find flakes that look very much like flakes of other 2D materials. They can, for example, have a hexagonal shape inherited from their precursor. We can use the same method that the community knows to separate them in different flake sizes. We can also transfer them from water to a variety of polar aprotic or protic solvents like alcohols or DMSO, DMF. And if you want to use nonpolar solvent, we will have to modify their surface, graft some molecules that make them soluble, but it's doable as well. So what basically we end up with? We end up with colloidal solution of two-dimensional particles that now can be used to produce films, coating, three-dimensional structures by a variety of non-techniques, spray coating, spin coating, dip coating, inkjet printing, doctor blading, you name it. Anything you know that can be used for any other colloidal solution, 2D materials can be used. We can print them, inkjet printing, just from aqueous solution. Moreover, they come in different colors, so we can have conducting color pictures and conducting ink. And again, remember, no annealing, no nothing, just water needed. And of course, they can be combined with other materials. Again, I won't talk about it today because I want to give you some flavor of properties and applications here, but this is the first paper reporting on polymer matrix composites with MXenes, and it was published in 2014. And this is a paper I pulled, published just 2 days ago, not the last maybe, but one of the last, on MXenes combined with graphene to produce very strong films with about 700 MPa or more than 700 megapascal strengths and other attractive properties. They can be introduced into ceramic matrices to add conductivity increase by orders of magnitude conductivity of ceramics, increase strengths and modulus. And they can be introduced into metal matrices. For example, in the case of light metal, addition of titanium 32 to a magnesium lithium aluminum alloy allows almost a double stress to failure without losing ductility with the same strain here. So why is this possible? Because they are very strong. Carbides and nitrides of transition metal are known to be among the strongest and hardest materials they're using to make machine tools, very resistant coatings. And of course, in two-dimensional flakes, this material inherit largely properties. So if we do indentation experiment, you also will see when indenter pokes through the film, actually, it doesn't break through, it doesn't explode, unlike, say, you might have seen graphene films over a hole stretched here. It just pokes a nice small hole. And while titanium 3C2 sheet will not be able to hold exactly the same load as a graphene sheet, but we're talking about ideal perfect graphene sheet when people talk about terapascal modulus. One that is grown by CVD or separated from a perfect single crystal. Anything solution process, for example, Jo will be here. Moly S2 will be here. Titanium 3C2 will hold high modulus and say in the first experiment about 17 GPa strengths, I'm sure material we have now have higher. Niobium 4C3 already jumped to 28 GPa strengths and modulus of about 400 gigapascal. So they're very strong materials. And only two actually have been mechanically tested so far. There is a lot to explore. There is a lot to go. They also have interesting electronic properties, I mentioned. Say, if you look at temperature dependence of conductivity of titanium 3C2, you will see it's metallic. And if you do annealing of this material cycle by cycle, remove surface termination, it stays metallic, just resistance decreases. But we can take materials which show the opposite behavior, titanium carbon nitride or moly titanium C2, which show semiconductor-like temperature dependence of conductivity. By removing intercalated molecules, surface termination, we actually can switch their behavior to metal-like behavior. And this is very interesting for many applications. Amazingly, having lower conductivity than copper, gold, or silver. In many applications, MXenes can not only successfully replace metal electrodes, and again, I am reminding you, it can be just painted, printed, coated from aqueous solution and dried, very simple way. But it can do a better job than gold in photodetectors, in electrodes implanted into brain because of a better match of impedance of MXenes, titanium 3C2 in this case, like in most examples I'm showing to you today, and tissue. It can also be used to print flexible electronics. And properties are tunable. So again, what is important in nanotechnology? It's not just making things small, it's being controlled them, give them properties we need. For example, work function can be changed by removing surface functional group, as I showed to you an example of conductivity variations, or just adding them or changing them. And we can do it as you see in the right range. And we go from OH terminated MXenes, move towards removal of OH, we increase work function. We start removing fluorine, we decrease work function here. And this is actually very nice in agreement with theoretical predictions. We showed that we can have 2 electron volt for OH terminated titanium 3C2. And we can go down actually to about 8 electron volts to, for example, oxygen terminated moly carbide MXenes, titanium 3C2 will be located here. And this is what we're doing. And this open right away opportunities. We can make transparent conducting films by, for example, assembling films on the interface just on the water surface, pick those films and make transparent films, which are not single layers. We still don't know how to grow a wafer size, at least single layer film of titanium carbide or moly carbide or other MXenes. But we can assemble them from patches of these flakes into single layer film. And in cross section, it will look like a monolayer, and you can pick film from the surface 5 times and you get something which will look like a 5 layer of material. And we can use MXenes film by spin coating or deep coating or by dry spray coating. And for example, use it as transport layer in perovskite solar cell. This is this very, very thin layer here in the separating ITO and the perovskite. But by tuning work function, it's possible to improve efficiency greatly from just 5% in the material, same cell without MXenes to 17% or more. And actually, when we published this work in collaboration with colleagues from Jilin University and with Miyasaka from Japan, in the same week, paper appeared from Aldo Di Carla and a Russian scientist from Moscow State, also reporting use of similar approach. So communities starting to move, basically exploring this property, many research groups around the world. In a very similar way, I'm showing you a paper published just actually yesterday on the 30th of April on using MXene for electrodes for light emitting devices. And this is a collaboration with Seoul National University Group, showing that basically it can give a high current density at low voltages at ITO and pretty much largely perform like ITO. But again, there is no indium there, and it can be very easily at room temperature, just printed, sprayed on the surface, and it can perform equally well here. But again, jumping to further variety of properties. What you see here are just UV spectra of different MXenes. And you will see these peaks of light absorption, which actually plasmon resonance peaks. And they come at a variety of different positions for different MXene compositions. So we basically can have material of any possible color, plasmonic color, absorbing at different wavelengths. Titanium 3C2 will have this absorption band at about 7-8 nanometers, which defines application, for example, like a destroying cancer cells by using red light here. Moreover, this position of this band can be moved electrochemically by 100 to 150 nanometers. So we can make electrochromic devices that will change their color as we apply just 1 volt voltage, and we will go from blue to green, for example. So some people, and this is a paper by Hussam Al-Sharif from KAUST from Saudi Arabia, suggests that we can design electronic devices, optoelectronic devices, just using all this variety of MXenes with different surface termination, with different transition metal, different structures, calling this emerging X area MXtronics, because we can have tunable electronic, magnetic, plasmonic, spintronic properties, tunable work function, band structure, charge transfer, optical response. We can do it by varying functional groups, intercalating different atoms, injecting charge. And again, we have all this variety of structures I started with and talked to you about here. It's quite exciting. Again, I'm sure we will use a variety of different materials, but it shows that, again, just like we were talking about in carbon, that we can build entire carbon electronics and carbon world. Now we have other materials. Now combine those with just all this variety of carbon and a structure, and we really have plenty to work with. Let me just move from electronics, optoelectronics, optics, controllable electronic, optical, mechanical properties to other fields. We actually can use the same properties. What is very important? As long as we know fundamental chemical and physical properties of the materials, we can think of a variety of different applications. I mentioned to you just a couple of minutes ago that titanium 3C2 MXene, which is actually also biocompatible and biodegradable material, can absorb light at 7-8 nanometer near infrared. And also, I talked to you about hydrophilic functionalized by oxygen or H surfaces of material and intercalation, where variety of molecules can be adsorbed or intercalated between the layers, just like in a clay or graphene oxide. So what scientists have demonstrated that it's possible to inject MXene dispersion particles, and it's also possible to make even quantum dot sized particles into tumors and ablate them using near infrared array light. And simultaneously, it's possible to absorb drugs like doxorubicin and do theranostic approach exercise when we have particles which can destroy tumors and do it much deeper under the skin because of different wavelengths. Let me just jump back for a second. You can see we can have materials absorbed in a near IR range like titanium 3C2, but going further, V2C, niobium carbide, and some other materials that actually absorb in the infrared range here. And this certainly opens other opportunities for these materials here. I just talked about adsorption of drugs a minute ago, but there are many other molecules that can be adsorbed. And we are facing a crisis in the US because of the coronavirus. And I took this picture and the title from a news story just a couple of days ago that US is racing to stock up on dialysis supplies because kidney failure is one of the consequences of many cases of coronavirus COVID-19 disease here. So organs get damaged and patients need dialysis. And one of the problems with dialysis is that urea molecules are very difficult to adsorb. There are no good sorbents, but it's necessary to adsorb a variety of other uremic toxins. And MXenes is capable actually adsorbing urea much more efficiently than carbon or any other sorbent. And it has no toxicity, very good hemocompatibility, and can also adsorb much, much faster compared to current sorbent. So we can talk about not only increasing efficiency of dialysis machines, and this is a large dialysis machine you saw on the previous slide, but we can also talk in eventually even about developing wearable kidneys that patients can be treated at home. And of course, there are many other applications when we use the same property of ability of adsorb molecules, adsorb selectively, adsorb either on the surface or between the layers, and change properties by this adsorption. For example, when gas molecules are adsorbed between layers of MXenes, there can be a very significant change in electrical conductivity of MXenes. Moreover, traditionally, people use semiconductors as gas sensors. And semiconducting sensors need to be heated to say 200 degrees to be able to show sufficient conductivity. MXenes can do it at room temperature and it's metallic. It's actually like in many other applications I talk about today, it really becomes a game changer because we can use different principles here. We actually get a lower noise and better signal to noise ratio just because of this high conductivity of MXenes and very high sensitivity to a number of different gases and molecules here. In my group, we work to a very large extent on energy storage applications. And this is the one I'm actually not going to talk about today. I gave many talks and you can find some of them recorded online about use of MXenes in supercapacitors and various kinds of batteries, battery electrodes, passive materials, current collectors, separators, binders. There are many applications here because as we move into the future, we're again looking for batteries that can be embedded into textiles, that can be made transparent, that can be combined with solar cells. Batteries actually that can be charged much faster compared to current battery. Elon Musk promised us the Tesla battery will be charged within 5 to 10 minutes. What do we need to make a battery that charges quickly? We need material that is first of all very highly conducting, really metallically conducting, because large fast charging simply means running a high current through a device. If your device is a resistor, you will be heating it, not charging it. So we need to bring new materials with this very high conductivity like MXenes, but ability to store charge on the surface and not only in double layer, but also by charge transfer. And this is what you can do in transition metal. This is how charging batteries stores largely, by changing oxidation state of transition metal, but doing it without diffusion, because in two-dimensional material, the entire material is the surface. There is no solid-state diffusion. And naturally, the research community has already been testing MXenes in pretty much almost every electrochemical application possible. From electrochemical capacitors, and largely we pioneered this work in science. My former student, Maria Lukatskaya, was the first one to show this possibility. Now she's a professor at ETH Zurich. Lithium sodium ion capacitor, Yamada Group in Japan pioneered this work. Lithium sulfur battery, Linda Nazar was the first one to show application of MXenes there, but since that, lithium sodium magnesium aluminum ion batteries have been explored. Hydrogen evolution, HR, hybrid energy storage devices, on-chip printable energy storage, textile energy storage, many others. What is also important, we often underestimate role of current collectors and binders in efficient energy storage and also energy generation devices. For example, I recall lecture of Ronlin Wang when he was talking about tribal electricity and contact electricity here. Imagine replacing metal foils with 10 or 100 times thinner layer of printable or solution process conductor here. And I already mentioned electrode, electrochromic device application. So it's a whole range. Again, this would be a subject of entire lecture. So I'm just going to skip it. I'll show you two examples, just to show you a few things that I believe are important. For example, let's talk about electrochemical capacitors, supercapacitors, something I'm pretty familiar with because my group has been working on this subject for about 15 years now. If you look at cyclic voltammograms of MXenes in a protic electrolyte sulfuric acid, you will see that it's a very wide but electrochemically reversible redox peak overlaid on a double layer capacitive envelope, where double layer capacitance come from double layer on the surface, and this broad redox waves come from changing oxidation state of titanium as we change termination from oxygen to OH. What is interesting, we can have a clear redox process at rates going up to 100, even actually 200 volts per second, with only losing, say, 20-30% of initial capacitance. What it shows is it's possible to have a redox energy storage at millisecond rates. We just need to have material that has electronic conductivity combined with ionic conductivity, protons are very fast, and no solid state diffusion. So we can push batteries far beyond of the rate they're operating right now before, if we have the right material. Moreover, this is example of titanium 3C2, and it goes to about 500 farad per gram. So several times higher gravimetrically, and actually at least 10 times probably higher volumetrically. And this is what matters in the battery size is the key, compared to say double layer capacitors. But if you look at DFT prediction, it's actually one of the poorest materials expected. The best materials are here, like zirconium nitride. So what is important? Even with this record-breaking values of conductivity, mechanical strengths, electrochemical performance, we are very far from selecting the best materials among MXenes. We're very far from reaching the best properties of material. We use moly 2C, for example, which is great material for HR. Hydrogen evolution is a catalyst here, but it's not a good material for energy storage at all. Moreover, what is also another challenge we are facing when we try to use nanomaterials in energy storage in batteries, supercapacitors, we have irreversible first cycle reaction. Moreover, things that we used to and consider to be standard in the field, like for example, certain electrolytes, they don't work. For example, acetonitrile is considered to be the best electrolyte solvent for electrochemical capacitor because it gives the highest conductivity of the solution, but it gives actually the worst capacitance compared to DMSO or 10 times lower conductivity propylene carbonate solution. Why? Because acetonate trial will go along with lithium ions in lithium ion electrolyte and will lead to both expansion of interlayer space, and you see about 13 angstrom, and fluctuation. So basically brazing of the electrodes, change of dimension as we cycle it. In case of DMSO, we actually will get fast transport, but we have even larger changes in the spacing, even larger spacing, 19 angstrom, when we cycle electrochemically the material. But when we use propylene carbonate, the solvent will not go along with lithium. There will be just lithium ions going between the layers. There will be stable dimension of the electrode. It will be the smallest spacing, just about 11 angstrom. See latest parameter change here. So what it means that whenever we need use whenever try to use new materials, we also need to reconsider how we design our battery, how we select electrolyte, how do we select counter electrode. And this is important to remember for people who just try to take a new material and replace an existing one. But if you do it right, we can open a very large domain of opportunities. We can make printable devices, we can make wearable devices, we can actually make not only supercapacitor embedded in glass, we can make a sensor, we can make energy harvesting fabric tank, triboelectric nanogenerator, we can make a energy storage, and we need it, or we can print them on a silicon chips and make devices, for example, for AC/DC conversion, line filtering. It's about 100 devices on a chip work done with Hussam Al-Sharif at Kaust. And of course, we can use transparency of this material. And this is work with Valeria Nicolosi, Johnny Kalaman's group from Trinity College. When a layer of MXene makes a transparent supercapacitor with, again, higher volumetric capacitance compared to a variety of other nanomaterials or conducting polymers here. And in many cases, most cases actually I discussed so far, we were talking about thin transparent films. But like battery supercapacitor, you may need something different. You may actually have to need a thick electrode for a large battery device where you don't want to have flakes aligning along the surface, as it happens when you use spin coating or other techniques. You want to be able to align them vertically. And it's again possible to initially working with Shu Yang from University of Pennsylvania. We did it by adding liquid crystal. But what we learned later, collaborating with colleagues from Deakin University, that pure MXene in water solution, again, with no additives, no surfactant, no nothing, can form liquid crystal solutions. What matters is just selecting right concentration for the right flake size. And if we have a liquid crystalline solution, we can, for example, draw fibers as shown, and this paper was on the cover of SAS Central Science earlier this year in February. We can draw fibers. We can make continuous fibers of, again, pure titanium 3C2. And this is SCM micrographs, how the fiber looks like. And depending on the bus used for gelation, we can have lower density or we can higher density, so we can control properties. One will be better for adsorption for electrochemical application, another will be giving much higher conductivity. We actually go close to 8,000 Siemens centimeter, which is extremely high, significantly higher that can be achieved in other fiber type. And we can use this conducting fiber, for example, as a heating element, or you can use it for energy storage, for the same pseudo-capacitive energy storage that I discussed for the film before here. But of course, there are many, many other applications. And of course, if you have the solution, which you can highly dilute or concentrate and make a slurry, basically, which is a liquid crystal, again, behaves like a clay. So when flakes align naturally relative to each other, we can use a very, very simple technique. We can use blade coating, doctor blading. And here you can see a meter and a half long tape, 10 centimeter wide in this case, produced just by spreading and drying the slurry. And this is, again, let me mention why I'm dwelling so much on manufacturability. There are many, many exciting materials. And one of the reasons also that graphene got so much attention using graphene oxide, that we can manufacture more than a few flakes on a substrate. We can really manufacture tapes, films, coatings on large areas. We can do the same things with MXenes. We can make large amount of material itself by wet chemical synthesis. And we can process this material just after washing, making a solution with the right concentration and process into a film, which is actually very strong. This film has about 15,000 Siemens per centimeter. And it goes strength up to 570 MPa. There are no additives here. It's a basically bonding between larger, about 5-10 micron flakes of titanium carbide MXene in this 1 micron film roughly, or sub-micron film where they align. And this film can be used actually for a variety of proper applications. It can be current collector for electrodes. We're talking about 570 MPa strength. It's as strong as an aluminum foil. Aluminum has a strength between 400 and 600-700 MPa for drone materials. The foil is usually probably about 100 MPa only strength. And we can, for example, make antennas for 5G internet. And we showed that they can perform basically very close to copper antennas. We can make RFID tags, which are, again, are printable from aqueous solutions. And for example, from the very first attempt, we were able to read it from 8 meters. And keep in mind, I'm not talking about anything optimized. I'm talking about materials that were made from first attempt. This is like a zero generation. Moreover, actually, much of this work, including this one, was done with no financial support, just exploring the idea. So imagine how much one can achieve by truly exploring, by pumping at least 1% of the amount of money that went into developing of graphene or other better studied material here. Another actually record-breaking application is electromagnetic interference shielding. Going back to Internet of Things, to smaller devices. We have electronics communicating around us everywhere. So it's very important to avoid crosstalk on devices in the same, say, cell phone, or between different devices in the Internet of Things world. So we need to achieve shielding of those devices. But again, we cannot use 15 or 30 micron copper or aluminum foil that have been used for a long time, or metal meshes. We need better materials. But you see, for example, if you talk about carbon polymer composites used largely today, we're talking about a millimeter or two thick structures. This is something you use, for example, when you buy a credit card wallet to protect it from credit cards being read. Graphene is somewhere here located. And you can probably push by high temperature annealing the performance a bit further. There was a very recently very nice paper by Huimin Chen and Vinsai Ren from Institute of Metal Research on better performance. But actually, titanium 3C2 MXene, and this was the very first paper published on electromagnetic interference shielding of MXene with Chunmin Ku from KISP, showed actually performance in line with much, much more conducting copper, aluminum, other metals. Moreover, we can achieve 15 decibel required for majority of practical application with a 1 or 2 micron thin film. And actually, we have now materials which perform better than copper at the same thickness. This is clearly anomalous behavior when we cannot treat MXene as a continuum. We need to consider discrete interaction of electromagnetic wave with MXene, but bottom line, we do have very thin coating. Moreover, for some of the application, it's sufficient to remove 99% of electromagnetic radiation, and it can be done with 40 nanometer films. And in this recent study, which was published in the CS Nano this month in the April issue, our group looked at 16 different MXenes, structures 2-1, 3-2, 4-C structures, different compositions, actually also solid solution MXenes. You see, they're all different. They have very different colors. Those are films of several representative compositions. And you can see that for some of them, we can establish for the same thickness film dependence of EMI on conductivity. But for some others, they actually deviate from the expected dependence. And we are still trying to understand the mechanism of this behavior, which we believe really quantum behavior of these materials here. But it just shows that we can have absolutely outstanding performance that at the moment, no other material can beat here. And actually, I'm approaching 1 hour, and I want to leave some time for questions and discussion. So I'm going to summarize what I've said. This diagram, which was published first time in the paper that I showed in my first technical slide, demonstrates range of application of MXenes. I just highlighted some of the electronic, optical, biomedical applications today. There are many others. I mentioned that we work a lot and we actually started exploration of MXenes with Professor Barzum from energy applications, from lithium-ion batteries. And you see how much has been done already there. Electrocatalysis is another very quickly expanding region. I did not even talk about water purification, desalination, both capacitive desalination and membrane desalination purification, or gas separation, when spacing between the layers can be controlled with a very high accuracy. EMI shielding technology, which is really already very close to becoming practically used here. But if you look at when this research started, some of this were explored very recently. The first paper on biomedical application of MXenes appeared in 2017, and they're already being explored for photothermal therapy, for electrodes, implantable electrodes, and pretty much every kind of electrode that can be used in medicine here. Drug delivery, imaging with MXene quantum dots, urea removal, dialysis, many, many other applications, biosensors, structural, it's just starting to develop. Two of all these numerous materials have been experimentally tested mechanically as a single flake so far only here. Exploration of electromagnetic properties like a shielding started in 2016, and it is the best material known today. And moreover, if you look at how much work has been done on different MXenes, 2/3 of it work done on a single material from this large family. As I mentioned, at least 100 of stoichiometric compositions are possible, and probably certainly more as we discover new arrangements of atoms in those structures and unlimited number of solid solutions. And this is this one. Is this the best one? It's actually a good one. Titanium and carbon both are very abundant element. This is a material that can potentially be produced at low cost. We know that it's non-toxic. It's a soluble in water, forming stable colloidal solution, great material. Does it have the best medical, electronic, magnetic, catalytic, optical redox properties? Of course not. It's simply the first one studied. It just simply shows how much room is at the bottom here for exploration. And then not only one study in MXenes now, of course, Drexel University still publishes lots of paper with our group, Professor Barzum's group, and a number of other researchers working on MXene. But if you look at the web of science, there are publications already coming from about thousands of different institutions around the world. China leads in both number of institutions, number of publications, accelerating crazily. But Korea, Singapore, Japan, Australia, Sweden, many other countries. Actually, I found more than 55 countries. I'm sure there are activities in many other countries going on. You can find more than 100 or more than 1,000 returns in Google Patent Scholar. So it's a developing field. Still, compared to the chalcogenides, graphene areas, we are just starting to explore it. We're making first baby steps in that field. So it means that there is a lot to find, a lot of excitement, a lot of things to do. And there are many challenges as well. For example, we need to learn how to control defects in MXenes. For example, I showed you values of Young's modulus for titanium 3C2 close to 300 GPa, but theoretically it should be about 470. Why? Largely we believe, and modeling done by Gary Tucker suggested, it's because of defect. For example, we see this point defects missing atoms on the surface of material, entire clusters of defects. How we control them? They're definitely bad for mechanical properties. They're bad for chemical stability, environmental stability, and conductivity. But they actually may be very good for other applications, for catalysis. We know also we can place single atoms and platinum in these holes opened by removing transition metal and make a great catalyst. After very substantial efforts, the community learned how to make graphene, boron nitride, dichalcogenides on a wafer scale. Maybe not huge single crystals, but cover surface with a variety of crystals. For MXenes, these efforts are just starting. 2-3 nanometer thin crystal have been reported. Vince Irian, Huimin Chen at Institute of Metal Research were again the first one to show them, but it's still not a monolayer. So again, people who work on CVD, PVD methods, should learn how to make them on a silicon wafer, how to make non-terminated MXenes, that we can look into some physical properties and get physics community more excited, because they will get familiar materials grown on a wafer with no termination, no nothing on the surface here. We still learn how to produce nitrides. Only very few nitride MXenes have been made so far, and virtually one type of carbon nitrides. They're all possible. Thermodynamics, DFT calculation tell us they're definitely possible. We need to learn how to make them. There have been also, inspired by discovery of MXene, many other structures predicted. Transition metal carbide, transition metal borides, transition metal nitrides, carbides and nitrides combined with different layers. They're predicted to be stable. Now we need to find a way how to make them. Can we make not titanium 2C, but titanium C2, titanium carbonate terminated by carbon? Can we make M-beans or boron basically containing MXene instead of carbon and nitrogen here? We need to learn how to control surface chemistry, improve environmental stability. We already have a number of MXenes can even in single layer flaking solution stay for months without degradation changing properties. But still they're not as stable as pure say graphene sheet. And we need to push further. Many other properties, how control defects. I already mentioned it briefly, but also exciting property changes, electronic properties have been predicted. And defect engineering has been used for a number of other materials. So we need to learn what the community has done for other classes of nanomaterials and apply this knowledge to MXene. Many of it is in theoretical prediction, including ferromagnetism and topological insulators, MXenes need to be explored here. And there are many other things we need to understand. So again, we are in the beginning of the road, but this has been a really exciting journey so far. And we have not been going alone. This work that I showed to you is a very small part of what has been done already for MXenes, tip of the iceberg. But it took efforts of dozens of scholars at Drexel University. This is my group at the summer party last summer. This is not the whole group, but you see it's a pretty large and diverse group. So I cannot list here all the students, postdocs, visiting scientists who participated in this research. I cited papers, you saw published work, you can find their name. We also have been collaborating with a very, very large number of people from all over the world. You will find here a short list of collaborators. Definitely not all of them, I just cannot fit them. But again, if you look at the papers that I cited, you will find many names. I've also been working with many colleagues in China. For the last few years, I've been affiliated with Jilin University. Professor Yu Gao was actually my former visiting student. He is a faculty now in the College of Physics at Jilin University, where I had an appointment for 3 years. And we had a laboratory just we were running jointly. And much of the work has been done there, but also with Professor Bin Shu at Beijing University of Chemical Technology. And you, Alex, organized the first MXenes conference 2 years ago in Changchun at Jilin University. And Bin Shu, and this conference brought about 200 people together. Bin Shu organized the second MXenes conference in Beijing a year ago, in May last year, which brought together 450,000 people here. And we were planning to have the conference this May. Unfortunately, the coronavirus changed the plans. But before I show you a slide for that conference, I wanted also to mention this work has been funded by many sources in the United States. The first funding came from Department of Energy, and it has been continuing to fund this work through different divisions, particularly through the first Energy Frontier Research Center nowadays, but many other funding agencies in the US, National Science Foundation, DOD divisions, but also international sources, ranging from Israel to Korea, Qatar, China, of course, and Murata is the company that has been a first adopter of the technology already manufacturing MXenes. So again, we expected again to probably double the number of attendees, go well above 450 in this conference. We still hope it will happen. Chinguan in Ningbo is the chair of this conference. So far, we postponed until September. Stay tuned, mark this website, bookmark it, and monitor what happens. We're also planning to have a conference to celebrate 10 years of MXenes discovery at Drexel University, organizing together with Professor Michelle Barzum, my colleague at Drexel University, scheduled for August, whether it will take place, will be online, we don't know. If we cannot do it as a full conference this year, we will organize it definitely next year to do the celebration. But it shows the community is growing. And if you're interested in MXenes, I think it's a great field. There is so much to explore, to discover. We already have record-breaking progress. We have very interesting physics and chemistry where we can tune, modify so many different features of these materials here. You can read in our book published and really many, many leading researchers from all over the world contribute a chapter to this book. This may be a next step in your exploration of this field, but there is so much need to explore this material. So for all the young scientists and not only young and beginning scientists in the field, this is a great research area. You're welcome to join MXenes exploration. You're welcome to join discovery. And if you have new materials, we will have new technologies, and hopefully they will help us to make our world better, greener, and safer. Thank you very much for your attention.
Great, Yury. It's a very, very impressive talk. We are so proud of you, Yury. Yeah, can you hear me? I'm so proud to tell you. Yeah, so today is an international, you know, holiday for the Labor Day. So till now, we have close to 9,000 audience online. Yeah, so your talk are so attractive. We got a lot of questions. here I try to, you know, directly go to the question part. Okay. Yeah, we give the students more time to answer questions. Okay, we got the first questions. Okay, the first question is from EPFL. Thanks for your impressive talk. I have a question about transfer of MXene using inkjet printing. You mentioned that typical lateral dimension of the MXene flakers are 10 micron. Since the inkjet printing is a nozzle-based technique, so the diameter of such nozzle may be an issue for the printing. How can you be sure, you know, the structures integrated of MXene could not be damaged by the printing process? Thank you. Is that clear?
Well, this is a very good question. Inkjet printing is actually a very versatile technology. And first, it's possible to make flakes smaller. It's actually easy. Just by sonicating the solution, it's possible to decrease the flake size down to, say, about 100 microns with horn syndication. But for some applications, you really want to have large few micron flakes because they provide the highest conductivity and mechanical strength and stability. And it's possible to change the design of the printer head to print with larger particles. But this will require you to work with the printer manufacturer. And stay tuned. This work that we have done with one of the leading companies in the field will be published hopefully very soon this summer.
Okay, the next question is from Leibniz University. What are the advantages of films consisting of a single layer MXene over the films made by the multi-layers MXene? I understood that both of them are interlayer distance can be 10.
Okay. The advantage of single layer films that you can basically pack very nicely, like in papier-mâché film flakes. As a result, there is a large contact area between the flake and good electrical conductivity, low gas permeability, and high mechanical strength. When you have multi-layer flakes in solution, you get basically flakes like a stacks, and they always get under the angle. As a result, the film is less dense, much more permeable, and also less conducting. So if your goal to make strong, highly conducting, non-permeable films, you need to work with solution of single layer flakes. If your goal is to make a highly permeable film, for example, for electrode, where electrolyte should go in, you actually have an advantage when you use not fully delaminated multi-layer flakes.
Okay, third one. Yeah, so as from University of Cambridge, a challenge in the graphene industry is to fabricate a large area single crystal graphene. Is a large area single crystal MXene possible, and is that necessary?
Theoretically, yes. There is no reason why not. It seems to be straightforward now. People know how to make graphene. People make graphene on copper foil. Go back a decade. It did not come by itself. It was not was done on the first day. People were pulling single layers from millimeter-sized crystals, just like with graphene or molydisulfide or boronitride. It's necessary to work on optimization of the process, on extreme control of the process. If it's possible to grow 100 micron-sized, a couple of nanometers thin film of moly carbide, it should be possible to make MXene, but we don't have it yet. Is it necessary?
Okay,
I don't have an answer to this question. It's exciting to learn about its properties. Do we really need it for some applications? I don't know. We definitely will get very high conductivity. We can run extremely high current through these films. Actually, they're very stable, but we can probably do it easier and definitely much cheaper by using flakes from solution so far. If you make a film like that, we will learn.
Next question is a graduate student from Henan Agricultural University. It's my hometown. Yeah, I want to ask something about the difficulties in preparing MXenes-based supercapacitor or microcapacitor and how to overcome all these difficulties. Yeah, thank you.
Well, this can be a subject of an entire talk. Actually, just a week ago, I was giving a talk for a seminar series organized by Moscow State University. And I spent about half of the time, at least 20-25 minutes, talking about supercapacitors with MXenes. This talk is available on YouTube. So if you can sneak out and get to YouTube from China, you should be able to read more about it. But let me just talk about a couple of challenges. One of the key challenges is to actually make permeable electrodes. And this is exactly where we need to have MXene flakes aligned differently, misaligned. We can do it by different means. We work with colleague from Hozhong University of Science Technology to add, for example, knotted carbon nanotubes and prevent alignment and restacking of MXene flakes. It's possible to make templating. It's possible to use liquid crystalline MXene to vertically align flakes. And this is really, I would say, electrode architecture design is an important factor to make good supercapacitor electrodes with MXenes. There are many other challenges, expanding voltage window in aqueous and organic electrolytes, improving lifetime. That's a very, very large field.
Okay, great. We have many questions. Okay, the fifth one. Okay, which is the fifth one? As Jessica from Beijing University of Chemical Technology, what surface modification method can increase the concentration of MXene in organic solvent?
Oh, good question.
This is from chemical, you know.
Yes. That's actually a question I don't have a good answer to. I would like to know myself. We can really very well get stable solution of MXenes in water, which is a great solvent. And in organic solvents, we do get colloidal solutions, but keeping them stable is possible, but having flakes really completely solvated is a challenge. So my feeling is, it's more about maybe finding the right solvent rather than do simple surface chemistry. And of course, you can graft molecules that will adjust surface chemistry. For example, putting hydrophobic functional groups on the surface to make materials soluble in nonpolar solvents. Thanks here. But again, in most of the work we have done so far, with a few exceptions, we try to avoid it because what we saw, one of the key advantages of MXene, ability to work without changing anything. In semiconductor quantum dots field, metal nanoparticles, graphene, carbon nanotubes, one of the key problems is the need of these surfactant additives, which need to be after that removed or they kill majority of properties of the material. And if you have to remove them by heat treatment, you limit number of substrates, you can use mesoprocess complex here. But definitely, I think exploring same methods people use to other 2D materials, 0D material, 1D materials is probably the way. So if you find a way to better control solutions of MXene organic solvents, let us know, we will learn from you.
Okay, great. I see that we choose two more questions, okay, because it's really popular. A lot of people ask questions. Yeah, so it's Liu from Harbin Institute of Technology. He wants to ask a question about MXene future, both on the science research and applications. No, yes, a ground future.
It's bright. It's not as dark as the background you can see now for iCANX talk here. In science, I just highlighted very few things. We are working on making, for example, two-dimensional magnetic MXenes. Antiferromagnetic, ferromagnetic properties have been predicted. They may enable major progress in spintronics. It's exciting. Making MXene with tunable superconductivity, as Boris Jakobson predicted, would be great. Topological insulators are definitely of great interest to physicists here. I already told you we have really anomalous interaction of MXenes sheets with electromagnetic waves. There is some exciting work that I hope will be accepted and published soon, which really breaks completely our understanding of interaction of electromagnetic waves with metallic materials. And there is certainly very interesting science. But what I try to do throughout my talk is convince you that those are real materials. We don't have a monolayer hidden on a silicon wafer under layer of graphene, or grown on silver substrate without ability to separate and study mechanical property or electrical properties of pure material. We have materials that can already be produced in hundreds of grams and kilogram quantities, which can be easily dispersed processed from aqueous solutions, which can be produced in films in very simple method in any areas and in a variety of other structures. So it means that applications are there. This material that can find practical application because it's available. It's a matter of, again, industry adopting it, understanding advantages, finding where this material can replace other materials. And if you want me to bet on something, I would say electromagnetic shielding antennas, they are by far better than anything we have and know so far. What will be other applications? I'm sure there will be. No one would probably predict in the beginning of the nanotube research era that additive to battery electrodes would be probably the largest volume application of carbon nanotubes so far. No one predicted that diamond-like carbon will enable data storage.
Yeah, I choose our very last questions because we have such a big group audience, you know. Yeah, many are new in the field, many are still out of the door. They won't join that. So this question from National University of Singapore, she is, thinks she wants to join. Since too many researchers around the world are doing study on MXenes, where should I start from? I'm planning to diving into this world. I was new to MXenes, but follow the MXenes research after a long time. Okay, some suggestions?
This is an easy question. Imagine tens of thousands of researchers studying just graphene. And there are not tens, potentially hundreds of thousands of MXenes composition and just a couple of thousand people working on them. So if I were doing it, I would look for other MXenes that have not been made yet. Predicted, make new materials. We are in my group are focusing now on exploring solid solution, understanding how tuning concentration of different metals changes properties, something that has not been done before. We believe again, major discoveries are possible here. And if you feel these applications, read about the properties and find where those properties can make a difference. So there is plenty of room for research. I'm sure you will find an exciting area to explore in the MXenes field.
Okay, great. Jump in. Okay, jump in. After Yury's talk, I think we'll be 10 times larger for the MXenes groups. Yeah, so this is really, really great. Okay, yeah, well, so proud of you, Yury. I have this certification. Yeah, it's an honor for iCANX-Talks to have you, a silver speaker, top scientist, you know, everything. Yeah.
I am taking this virtual certificate. Thank you very much.
That's for you, Yury.